everybody. I believe by now you've noticed our front of the church and that we are doing something a little different for a few weeks with our celebration of the foods that show up in the scripture and how we meet God that way. So the pulpit is often up there, but today it's not. And we have a display of other things. And I wonder if anybody notices something new on the altar. Fish, all right. Yay, in case you didn't notice, that would be today's theme. So it is the tradition of this church that before we enter into worship itself, that we would share first any announcements and then passing of the peace. So are there any announcements for the life of the church or the community? Yes?
I'm Yvette, and I'm Sasha's sister, and it's my husband Jorge's 60th birthday. Actually today. Yeah. So we wanted to spend it here with you and in your church.
Well, Jorge,
we loved it.
So that will be one of the things that we're going to do today, actually. I think we might as well just go ahead and start with a singing Jorge happy birthday. Are there any celebrating life today. We give thanks for the blessing of life and health for as long as we are gifted to live in this world. And we give thanks for the gift Mary up into this blessing too. And we bless every heart and mind and body. So that sort of jumps us into prayer mode, but that was our announcement. So there you go, that's a pretty cool announcement. Are there any more casual announcements that anybody has? Then please, let us pass the peace. Rise and greet those that you know and you don't know. Make everyone feel at home.
Whale and sun.
Later I opened the fish's body, separated the flesh from the bones, and ate him. She's got photographing with her son right now, so she's got some sight. And Eileen's husband, David, successfully underwent surgery for his back, and he's beginning to walk up and down the stairs, is my understanding. Other prayers? Yes,
For peace and healing in war-torn countries.
For peace and healing in war-torn countries, and there are so many of them, and also countries being hard hit by fires, our own nation, dealing with wildfires, violence in places where violence does not belong, changes in climate or environment that are affecting our world. Other prayers? Gratitude for right now and this beautiful fall day and the chance to have a creative weekend and celebrate the beauty that is all around us. Then let us offer a moment of silence. Hold silence while I read this prayer. Oh, holy God, we do give thanks for this beautiful world, for the pumpkins and the leaves, the changing seasons, the changing air all around us that reminds us that the earth too changes, like our bodies change, and that there are seasons in our lives and seasons in your creation, and that you are present in each and all of them. We ask you to be present in those places that go named and unnamed. Our partner church, the Chicago Church in the city of Utah, the nation of Zimbabwe, all those places that are experiencing warfare and violence, all those places that are devastated right now by fire and by flood and so many other disasters, all those places that are quietly beautiful and offering restoration and healing, like this village and this valley. And for all lives and bodies that need your presence, there is none of us that does not need your presence. And so we call you to us. We call you to be in our relationships and our hearts and our minds, and to remind us always that we are your hands and feet of love. And we pray together now, as you first taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now for a more traditional hymn, Psalm 304 in the red hymnal. Jesus calls us toward the hymnal. Many stories that are possible. Sandy, would you like to read the first one? chapter 5, verses 1 through 11. Once while Jesus was standing beside the lake of Gennesaret, and the crowd was pressing in on him to hear the word of God, he saw two boats there at the shore of the lake, and the fishermen had gone out of them and were washing their nets. He got into one of the boats, the one belonging to Simon, and asked him to put out a little way from the shore. Then he sat down and taught the crowds from the boat. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, put out into the deep water and let down your nets for a catch. Simon answered, Master, we have worked all night. All night long, but have caught nothing. Yet if you say so, I will let down the nets. When they had done this, they caught so many fish that their nets were beginning to break. So they signaled their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both boats so that they began to sink. But when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, Go away from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man. For he and all who were with him were amazed at the catch of fish that they had taken. And so also were James and John, sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. Then Jesus said to Simon, Do not be afraid. From now on you will be catching people. When they had brought their boats to shore, they left everything and followed him. Listen closely to the reading that Sandy will now share with you.
From John, chapter 21, verses 1 through 14. After these things, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias. And he showed himself in this way. Gathered there together were Simon Peter, Thomas called the Twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two other of his disciples. Simon Peter said to them, I am going fishing. They said to him, We will go with you. They went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just after daybreak, Jesus stood on the beach, but the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, Children, you have no fish, have you? They answered him, No. He said to them, Cast the net to the right side of the boat, and you will find some. So they cast it, and now they were not able to haul it in because there were so many fish. That disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, It is the Lord. When Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on some clothes, for he was naked, and jumped into the sea. But the other disciples came in the boat, dragging the net full of fish, for they were not far from land, only about 100 yards off. When they had gone ashore, they saw a charcoal fire there with fish on it and bread. Jesus said to them, Bring some of the fish that you have just caught. So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore full of large fish, 153 of them. And though there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, Come and have breakfast. Now none of the disciples dared to ask him, Who are you? Because they knew it was the Lord. Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time that Jesus appeared to the disciples after he was raised from the dead.
our fish and its significance in the life of Christ, in the life of our faith, in different ways. And the first thing I want to do is find out, Mary, do you think you would help me do a puzzle that you don't have to be in charge of? We're going to get a bunch of adults to spell a funny word. If Gia helps, do you want to help? Do you want to come up? Do you want to help? It's okay if you don't want to, or maybe you don't. Maybe you can direct from where you are. We're going to see. Okay, but now I need 10 adults to volunteer. Oh, I know, I've got them out there. Raise your hand and come up here. I'm not too shy. All right, I've got one. Far left. So, Gia, where do you want to go? Y. Looks like a Y. Yeah, kind of a V, but we're going to flip it that way. Now, if you guys sort of like pull your pieces together, what does it look like? That one says Jesus. And this one actually, these are the letters for Ichthys, which means what? Fish. And it's also the acronym iota, chi, theta, epsilon, and sigma, which stands for Jesus Christ, Son of God, Savior. The earliest symbol for Christianity and Christ was not the cross. It was actually the fish. Because for a very long time, Christian communities were in danger when they were trying to gather and worship. They were not always safe. And so they created symbols that they secretly put in the places where they would meet. And so they used the symbol of the fish to indicate where you could find another gathering of Christians, because it meant Jesus Christ, Son of God, Savior, using the acronym Ichthys for fish. Thank you, grown-ups, for your help. Thank you, Gia and Aaron. Sorry to be so much directing there. I'm going to just hold this up so you can all see the symbol. Hold it up. Can you all see that? So this is what we were just talking about. So when we say that fish were important in the early lives of Christianity, literally, this was the call that brought them together. Please pray with me. Oh, holy God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable to you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Now, we picked two passages today, but there are tons and tons of fish stories in the Bible. And you may have other ones that come to mind when you think about fish in the scriptures, either in the Hebrew scriptures or the Gospels. Are there any that you particularly like or that you think of quickly when you are thinking about fish stories? Jonah is a huge one, absolutely. Yeah. Any other fish stories that you resonate with or that you think about? The loaves and the fishes. That story is told multiple times in multiple varied versions across every gospel. It happened more than once. 5,000 fish, 4,000 fish, multiplied out with just a few, feeding 4,000 people, sorry, 5,000 people. Any other stories that are important to you about water, about fish? Yes.
When you fall to see when you're out fishing, and there was a boat over the place,
right.
It was in a storm, and Jesus called the sea.
When Jesus called the sea during the storm, when they were out, and they were in danger. Genesis. When God created the world, God created fish. Which came first, people or fish? Fish. They're older than us. And what's one of the things that we are asked to do in Genesis? We are asked to care for the world into which we were placed. We are called into stewardship of this entire world, and that includes its waterways, its fresh water, its salty water, every waterway. We are in always constant connection with water. And as we focus on these different elements that are showing up in the scripture, it helps us remember that connection. What did you guys notice about the two stories? happy to vote for them. Kind of obvious, right? Is she? And in both cases, what was happening to Simon Peter's patch and the son's Zebedee's patch, were they having any luck? No luck. No fish. Peter complained that they'd been fishing all night. And then Jesus told him to put his nets out again and said, okay, tell me to, I will, right? And then the boats almost start sinking because they have so many fish in their nets. The nets are beginning to break and the boats are starting to sink and they need help. It's not just one boat, it's a few boats trying to bring in the catch. That story is the call story of Christ's earliest disciples. He helps them look differently at their own profession and catch fish in a different way, and then he asks them to put down their nets and actually follow him, to leave their livelihoods, to leave their identities and everything they know in order to walk with him during the few years that he is alive on the earth. And then the second story, the one that Sandy read for us, sounded a lot like the first one, didn't it? They were out fishing. They had no luck. And then somebody calls from the shore, hey, try it. Put your nets over there. And they try it again on the other side of a different place. And the nets are full and they bring in a catch. The difference between those stories is that one is at the beginning when Christ first meets his friends, his closest friends who always get it wrong and always ask questions and always seem confused. These simple, intelligent, hardworking people that he chooses to hang out with. He meets them on the shores of a freshwater lake that they call a sea. And he spends the next few years walking all over the place with them and preaching and healing. And then when he knows he's leaving, he sends them out to keep doing that. The second story is a resurrection story. It's a communion story. It happens after he died. People that had walked so closely with him had sat down to eat in strangers' and friends' houses, who had faced down tyranny, who had actually become afraid, who had denied that they ever knew him after he was killed, but were still grieving and felt terrible and at a loss because everything that they believed in and walked for was gone. They chose to go back to what they knew best. They went back to fishing. They went back to their boats and their nets, and they tried to comfort themselves by doing something that was as familiar as breathing. And again, they had no luck until someone from the shore pointed them in a different direction, asked them to try one more time, and then slowly they began to realize that the one that was calling them to look differently at the world again and to try one more time was again their Lord. And they went into the shore and they sat down and they had fish with them. A communion meal with fish. And Peter, who had denied Christ three times by a charcoal fire, was offered fish from a charcoal fire by the one that he had denied but that he loved so deeply. And he took the fish, and he's once more connected with his God. These sound like old stories, but how many of you have ever been fishing? How many of you can't stand about fishing? I confess that both of my grandfathers were fishermen, and they love to take their kids and their grandchildren out, but my family went camping, and the first time I ever saw fishing was when my aunt was gutting a fish. I didn't get the fun of throwing a line before I saw a gutted fish, and so I wouldn't even eat fish for 10 years. Then somebody introduced me to fish sticks, like those are supposed to be fish, and I like those. It took me a long time to like fish. But my grandfather, my stepfather, and my grandfather fished with their grandchildren, including our daughters. They would have the girls growing alive and learn what fun it was to wait and watch and sit and be in the stillness of creation. And for people who are fishing for pleasure and recreation, isn't that the connection? There's catch and release. You almost don't even care if you keep something. You really just want to be connected the way we are this weekend to this beautiful world. But sometimes things are out of balance. Sometimes our waterways aren't clean or protected. The river right up here, the Wildcat River, for which we are responsible, was in danger of becoming a hydroelectric dam not so long ago. There was a period of time when, to generate more power, the people that were willing to invest in dams and projects like that could actually bypass almost every form of protection and conservation measure there was. And so somebody had put in a proposal to build a hydroelectric dam on Wildcat. Unfortunately for us, this happened during a time when people had begun to recognize the damage that was being done to our wild, fresh waterways by such big dams and other kinds of projects that blocked the life cycle of the fish and changed the capacity for humans to enjoy it for recreation or for sustenance, and changed the health of the river forever. And so something called the Wild and Scenic Waterway Act was passed at a federal level. And it requires a vote of Congress every time new rivers are going to be protected. And it just so happened that this law was in place, and that the people that wanted to save the Wildcat were able to document that this was a wild and a scenic river, small as it is, and it was put onto that bill, and it was passed in Congress, and this little river was protected so that people can still go out and fish in it, or fish in the waters that connect them to the Ellis, and eventually to the Saco. We are responsible for this world. We are responsible for the place where the fish swim and where people are trying to make a living. In Gloucester, where commercial fishing happens, people keep saying that it's unsustainable, but the scientists and the researchers there are actually working with the commercial fishermen to change the design of the nets that are being used in deep sea fishing in order to protect species that shouldn't be caught up in those nets and yet allow the fishing industry to continue. When people are in conversation and they're paying attention, we can do things that will change the world, whether it is buying one fish at a time and buying only fish that are fished for in a sustainable way, or not using single-use plastics that end up in our planet's oceans. We are asked to remember, with every meal, with every day that we walk outside, where the goodness and blessings that come onto our plate or into our life come from, and that we are connected to them, and that when we pause and we give thanks for a meal, we are giving thanks for creation itself, from Genesis on down, and remembering that first request that God made of us, which is that we would take care of what has been placed into our keeping. Fish are the symbol of safety and gathering for early Christians. People were called called away from fishing and called back to fishing. They were called to leave their livelihoods and care for something more. And yet they never forgot what they knew. And we must not forget. A fish stick isn't a fish. But if you've seen somebody pulling a fish out of the water, or you've had to help fillet and debone and touch a fish in its natural state, or if you've worked to protect a whale or a porpoise or a turtle, if you are choosing a sustainable way of living, you are doing this out of the deep call of God to walk in a way that is good for each other and good for this world. To walk with love and awareness and justice with every choice you make, with every pause you take to give thanks before you take a bite of food. Ichthys. Jesus Christ, Son of God and Savior. His first sign was a fish. May we wear the fish in our hearts and in our minds. Thanks be to God. This refrain, taste and see. Baskets from different parts of the world. Last week when Mary Eads was talking about bread, we were celebrating World Communion Sunday, and you'll see here patterns from many different nations, including Zimbabwe, the nation with whom we have a partner church. We ask that you cloth and children who are asking questions. on this earth, and God of every creature on this earth. Bless what we offer you here today, and return always to our lives to tell us your stories, and to remind us of our connection to you, and this world, and each other. Thanks be to God. Amen. Alright, so this is a fun song, Down by the Riverside. How many people know this one? If you don't, go figure it out.
Thank you.
on this earth, walk joyfully under these skies, and walk gratefully by these water waves as you walk in peace.